As you all notice, there are two problems at stage. One getting them here. The second one is actually making them stand up. Yes, it is a fundamental problem. But of course, the practice that you can do with Spade is to hold on to it and lead it. As far as I know, the only dance implement where you actually helps you do nothing. Alright, so what's the purpose of today? I can't think how long there is no is a tumble to the fact that the dancers in this part of the world dance actually with the stage as distinct from dancers done during friendly procession. I always have to look at Barbara and say, when did we start at Bath? Set me off thinking about, well, there must be more to what's in the safe than we were commonly aware. So I started working at Salisbury to try and find out what references there were to the dancing that led to the giant. I came down to Shaftesbury to find the Bizan, the dancing that went with that, and so on. Now, all these things, there's very little known about them on the basis, I presume, that in fact they didn't really do much. You know, they had music and people wriggled around. You know, like they do nowadays. Why imagine it was any different in the past, you see? The stories that go with the book were absolutely great, of course. And I thought a good idea was to find out what was the South of England, can't make the South of England, ceremonial costume. What did people actually dress up? And that's when this Kenny archivist said, well, why don't I look at friendly society records? Because they are the rules specified how people should dress. And very rapidly found that there are thousands of these friendly societies. Each village had one, two, three, or even four. The records were scattered all over the place, although mostly to the Kenny archives that collected them together. And the most useful ones were at Cambridge and Taunton. Then I began to realise that there were stave heads in the museums in this part of the world. And particularly the Reading Royal Knight Museum had over 300 different stave heads and a lot of staves as well. I haven't seen the actual staves anywhere else to use. So I prayed into these things and began to find really happily that you quite naturally wore your best suit overcoat, you had a cockade on your hat, you know, that's a sort of what we now call gonzette, but there's something stuck up the side of it, and ribbons around your hat, probably a broad sash across one shoulder, and that was about it. You had to provide your own stave if you're an ordinary member, and the officials of the club would always have a special stave with probably a larger top than all of the rest. After the first score or so reading these, I didn't start making any notes, you know, it was always the same old thing. The worst thing about it, they were all coloured blue. You know, that made me wonder a great deal. Until after a while, when looking at clothing, I discovered that red was a colour reserved for the upper classes, and blue was the standard, because it was easy, cheap dye, was the standard for the workers. You know, it was what was red in the label. Whether in fact that meant really a social distinction, whether that's just convenience, I have no idea, and I don't really want to know. But still, I ended up there, and if you go through the many bus or some place, you'll often see a picture of local friendly society all lined up with staves of different sizes, all wearing their best clothes, possibly, I say, ribbons and cockade and things of that sort. Which, when you think about it, is what you would expect. Nobody could afford an extra clothes, a set of clothes just for the procession. They'd probably have a best suit, had it last for years and years before it became a working suit, and so on. So yes, it's absolutely natural. But it was in going through that that I found odd references to dancing. At the same time I discovered that, I then contacted the Red and Rural Art Museum, because they had these stables and they had rosettes on display, and that's when I discovered that rosettes are normally a part of horse harness, and they are raised. A rosette is like a rope, you see, it's actually a big solid. And the flat things that we all call rosettes are actually favours. You know, all the old references are to favours. You know, when you support a political party or a football side, you wear a favour, not a rosette. Which is one of those sort of interesting little things you find in Marshall. But we arranged, having discovered what they had and spoke to the curator, we arranged when a sort of couple of Americans visited to visit there to show them. They opened the cupboard and we saw the enormous collection of stave heads locked away because they couldn't display all these, and they're the ones who really picked things up on. And also tried to display them, they needed to borrow the stave. The difference in those staves and anything we've done there is that everyone was tapered. And that's either because of the natural wood, you know, which tends to grow thick at the bottom and thinner at the top in general, or they have been plain. Octagonal cross section was not uncommon from what we saw. But the result of that, of the taper, the weight, the centre of gravity was well down the stave. And with the stave head on the top, you had a very nice balance so that when you carried it, it didn't bang around on your shoulder. And I think it must have surprised the museum staff by actually dancing around outside of these staves. Because if you knew what we were doing. So that was an interesting thought anyhow. Now, further on the stage side of it, where there are surviving friendly society processions like Safe Party, which is near Petersfield, you find that, yes, they all provide a stage, but only the officials have a proper one. All the rest provide their own. And times I've been there, they tend to have willow, and they usually and they're carved in the bark. Something that I can remember my father at Flannery doing, but you know, something used to do on walks before the war, but I haven't seen anybody bother to do that sort of thing, whittling away to do it. But I noticed one year one of the young lads in the procession said, "I love you." You can see where he's wandered and so on. Everybody. And the same kind of thing, they also do what appears to be common in references, that when they get to the church, the priest didn't allow them to bring the slave into the church. They all had to be stacked into the porch and so on. What the symbolism of that is, I've no idea at this stage, other than you used to put bows and arrows and swords at the church door. So if you remember, in the late Middle Ages, one of the problems with church services was they didn't have seats. Nobody could understand the Latin, so they all amused themselves. And the Archbishop of York had to issue an injunction saying he would not have Morris dancing during the sermon. So it could well imagine that the local priest was not keen on people practicing archery, and why not come back with spears and so on, in other words. So again, I don't think it's anything symbolic here, it's just sort of good common sense. So there we are, that was the stage side. We'll kind of talk a bit more about that. So, costume, the stage. Now, the brass stave heads, and that's what's so attractive, you know, about the tradition of the stave. It's because the brass industry grew up in Bristol in the 19th century. And they were able to either stack these out or cut them out, you know, in a flat material. And it was cheap, a cheap way of doing it. And if you have a look at old ones, they're flat, they're made in our ferrule, which went on the end of the pole. Very sort of simple. Now, usually a club, I say, looking at the big collection of Reading, in which the curator, one of the curators, wrote a book illustrating most of these, each club was different if they were flat, anyhow, using some local symbol or some elaboration on what we call the spearhead. So, again, it's an opportunity, that's the book, yeah, to be individual, either individual within a group, within a team, or at least one team compared with another. And that's another attraction of the idea. It doesn't have to be brass. Nowadays, brass is not that cheap. Brass. It all depends whether you have access to a workshop at the local secondary school, you know, where they run it as a class exercise for you. But we did also discover that quite a few of the schools nowadays do cast aluminium, which you can then get nickel or cadmium plated, and that does look glorious as well. Or if you go with brass, you can actually get engraved. So again, there's endless opportunities for it. Unfortunately, when you look at the old pictures of the rest of the country, if you're more than about 50 miles from Bristol, they were wooden tops. Where I come from, in the middle of northeast Hampshire, it was sort of more like doorknobs or acorn shapes or pineapple shapes. Now, that's interesting because, of course, the sort of pinials you can get in the curtain pots, are these sort of shapes. And further, the grain you use, that's right, yeah. That sort of thing. That's another end. And you can get actually further lead type ends, you know, of various sizes, and all of them can be quite effective in that as well. They weren't the only thing that was stuck on there, of course. The other thing that there were floral decorations. And further down in Somerset, that's sort of contops over that way, the photographs show them with sort of great long floral decorations that might be 2 to 3 feet long. If you've ever seen pictures of the Tatty men at Hungerford, you'll get the right sort of idea. You know, the flowers are sort of made, what do you think of that sort? Might only last a day, but that's all we have to do. You see, because you don't keep them in the rain, why you shouldn't do them there. And so on, it's a little bit attractive. So that's it. Why they were mostly done by men is the same reason as that already all dancing in the 19th century was done by men. There was no point having women's friendly society when the women's money, as it were, wasn't owned by her, but actually owned by her father, husband, or brother. You know, that was the way the law was, and therefore societies which collected money and so on in the end, she didn't really have the right to draw on the money that lived at the end of it. Although a few women's societies, not many, the one that never slowly still goes on, and each year they have the so-called women walk around the table, gets reported from the local paper, and have a little posy of flowers rather than stay, it goes on. But it was relatively uncommon. Women were allowed in many of the British processions, looking at the old photographs, I understand often they either substituted for the man who should have been there, but just didn't need to come along anyhow. A procession around the village usually meant stopping the hostelries of various sorts, which then degenerated into dancing, country dancing, mixed sets, and so on and so on. And certainly at the end of the procession, it was quite common to find newspaper references to, in fact, a dance. You know, with the band that was involved with them play, and everybody in the procession on all the great, let's have a dance. So not an uncommon thing, say, in the South Region. I have seen photographs of equivalent thing in Scotland, a whole lot of people in kilts having their wee dram before they set up the procession and so on. So in my view is it's the friendly society, the procession, the stave is a sort of universal characteristic. The stave itself is a badge of office. You may have noticed in your local church that in fact there are probably two staves, and depending on who is able to suggest who the next liberal elector will be depends on what the badge is. Sometimes you have a crane for the king and a mighty bishop, or some equivalent of that.
The
church warden, that's right, two church wardens. You'll find Parliament has a black rod and a golden bowl, and so on. Even in the United States, the chief usher has a tipstaff, and he has a eagle on, and so on. So I mean, it's quite a common sort of thing. Most mayoral processions have somebody in the front carrying a wand or staff, usually meant to clearing away. Typically a staff, but sometimes it had a whip attached to it as well, and then we'll call a whiffler. But the task was still for me. In organisations, some of this organisation equivalent to equipment of masons and so on, again a short staff with badge office. Sergeant majors and so on, I think still officers will have short sticks as a badge and so on. Right, I mentioned the fact that often tapered. I didn't bring one that Barbara framed for me, but that was one of this sort of long, which is the machine like on a lathe that looked like a chair. It's sort of it's not straight. Very impressive, that's right. I don't see how you can reduce that sort of thing nowadays because wood lathe, the sort of science. Well, that's the length of it, in Harry Street. So, lots of things about that. Let's come on to the sources of the dance. I'm hoping later on today, when we have our next pause, I would like people who bought Spain to come on and talk about it and say, where did you get them? Why did you choose that? What do you find advantages from otherwise? Well, other than the fact that people with long ones tend to make them too nice. Very obviously. But the dance. I said that I found the first one was Sturt and Cornwall, or Sturt and Campbell, as a local team to assist on it. A little note, loose leaf note in the book, saying first and second parts to be practiced. You know, and these were referred on the whole to movements like the butterfly, double cross sides, and so on, right? That was all country dance titles. And the interpretation I put on that, we had to put some into the paper, but I mean, all this was sort of rather, I would say gibberish, but a bit vague, when we were sort of was in fact that first and second parts could be easy to put as figures and choruses. And if you converted the idea into trying the thing that we thought were figures and choruses, then the dance would look quite skiffy. Because obviously the movement seemed somewhat odd, make good choruses. So we found that was a convenient word, and that's what we talked about to start with. They made very satisfactory display dances. That's all the time. That reminds me of coming down to Mugs and Muckers one day in December when the weather forecast was, it's going to snow this weekend. So we turned up on the Sunday morning, wasn't it, Marie? I went over to start running a workshop and you sat in the house. Saturday, was it? Well, it seemed like and we had Sunday watching the weather of the basin. As soon as it started to snow, that was the end of the workshop. I'd be driving home to see ahead of the snow. It didn't happen like that. It actually, one moment it was nice, and the next moment it was blizzard. It was all hour and a half. Suddenly we travelled 3 or 4 miles to pick up Marley, by which time the village was cut off by the snow. And we sort of got eight on Monday.
Funnily enough, there was a
couple of
little ones.
Yeah, but all the power. The lorry clearing the snow away was just pushing it down the village street to the end of the street. So you can hear cars say, Things like the Dorsetshire March, Spithead Fleet, things like this, which I'm and also through the Hot Goes the Weasel and stuff like that. I mean, they were higher actually recognised. But this caused me a lot of problems, you see, but I never heard of dancing at the time like that. I went to the woman who tried and consulted and said, where do I start with it? For things like this. And he said, well, that sounds like early 19th century dance books, you know. Look through that. when you've had enough of that, here's the section of the British Museum library. So there's actually no problem finding notation repeated titles. In fact, what's even more surprising is, in fact, that given the time I bought it for an article, the notation I found was very similar. They were not quite what I expected at all. But again, they were rudimentary descriptions. I have tried the dancers, country dancers on people, those who were the Serendipity workshop in the 70s at Sidmouth. We actually had a whole session working our way through these to see whether they were good dancers or not. They were. You know, it's okay, it's good enough. And back home Western, somebody sent me a newspaper cutting. Now, unfortunately, when you send somebody a newspaper cutting, it helps to know what newspaper and what date. Just cutting it a little bit, you know, having an envelope, just a tiny bit of paper in it isn't terribly helpful. And I've not been able to trace where it was. That was good. But he described the fact that somebody got married at the local church, the people came over from Wiltshire, and they danced. They footed it and crossed over and danced the figure. That's it. So that was slightly more a challenge than some of the rest. So we're starting with something which was sure existed, right? And four-hand reels and country dancing were all part of the tradition, as it were. So anything connected in Dorset, Somerset, Wiltshire, you know, it was all fair game. Round there, in a part of the world, particularly the North Dorset, South Wiltshire, that the Friendly Societies actually danced with their staves. I would guess because they wouldn't dare leave them lying around. if you have an expensive item, you look after it, and so on. None of it was done in the Morris sense of doing shows. You know, the people dancing were all the people participating, they were doing it for fun. So the style must be the style that come across for country dancing, their social dancing. Of that sort of period, of which, again, there are a fair number of these, and so on. Now, what we are doing, or what we've been doing, is to take this material, interpret it into a show form, whoever it was done before, because that's sort of unknowable, right? Do a show form, and put them together to make a show, and actually dress up and make something of it. Adopting the ideas of your photographs, ribbons, haberdashery, ribbons, textures, the spheres, so that they flow and make a show of it, and find your style of doing. Before we really talked it seriously, Margaret and I had got friends together. That was an interesting experience to start with. We must have the oldest, the largest age range of any style we've ever had, right? 72 game weight. Yes.
Size-wise.
we found there was a type of engagement, you know, a sort of style of doing things that actually worked for us anyway. Anybody who, any group from the part of the world interested in doing things from the safe, who ever spoke to us and said, what's this, you teach me, and we've only been too willing to pass it on. We really haven't passed on to anybody further away, partly because they're not interested. We did run a workshop in Switch, but I think they discovered that over my past it was more interesting. Alan went to college in
Leamington,
that's right. I'm not aware of anybody else that far away who's taking interest. But I can see faces representing various groups here and so on. And that's really where we've got to. You know, Oh, yes, you know, I can remember that. With Marguerite Simon's story, it was a novelty. And what we found is that because of the background, social background, friends, there was actually much more spiel you could get your teeth into when talking to minors. On a vicarage, going up and things like this, you had Craig Coates, we actually started talking to people, they were all the younger. We used to get on quite well. And we got invited to dance at the church fete at Silchester. Now, Silchester is a Roman town, was a Roman town, I suppose, might use it, was. And the church is built more or less on the edge, part of the church arch inside, part of the edge inside. And they came along to dance at this fete, which is being held in the churchyard. And they took one look at this and said, would you mind dancing outside on the road? I've never come across this attitude. Pagan, yes. Absolutely no connection between stay dancing and paganism. I can assure you. As many sort of words in that matter.
But,
it works quite well. So most of the songs I'm aware of who have stayed with the repertoire have other things. A whole draft, well, they make up a whole draft of dance and song, which is part of the repertoire. I have no free one with it, it's just nice actually people enjoy doing it. The great advantage I think of having stayed in your repertoire is you have a big investment in the stage. And when you've got a dust of these things, very difficult to ignore. in many ways, I'm prepared the door as anything today. What I'd like to do, of course, is there aren't people here with things that they'd like to teach us, as it were, other than the original stuff. I'd be very happy for them to take a go, let's say after lunch. I can start by running through the basic material, if you're not familiar with it, or I can run through some of the things that I have picked up from people. Oh, I didn't mention the fact there are a number of teams in Slate who say dancers, and the most surprising of all, we were watching Wicker's World once, where he was broadcasting in Los Angeles, and in the background, there was a team of women dancing with bamboo poles. But I don't know what Wicker was talking about, I was so stained in the background. Our rural Felicity coming over in early July, the 22nd to the 5th of August. I think there's talk, we're going, being organised by a federal dam at Kumar. So they'll be in the West Country. For some talk, he said they wanted to be born. Right. They're a side that do have a set of stages. I don't know, but they do some things. Oh, that's right, yeah.
This is just the point that it's an opportunity to see our American cousins at the level of doing it. Yeah. And they hope to be at Sydney on the Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, but they fly back
nobody here who is not from a team does stay.
It's only a third. Yeah, but does stay. Somerset Maze, Court Square, and some other lot, who thought they had one of the dancers in common, and we got them the first eight bars. And discovered that, in fact, having common figures and choruses, in principle, didn't mean the dancers went the same.
That's true.
One of the great advantages of it, you know, in a sense, whatever you think about today, there's nothing today which is laying any down as a rule for doing something. It's just ideas through interpreting. You know, you can either ignore today, just have a good time, or not have a time. Okay? If you don't have a good time, complain to the manager, not to me. Right? But I'll tell you what, I bought 32 of these things that go up the side of stairs. They don't bend and they hurt. But they are long enough to actually carry over the shoulders on. So if you want to use one, you bought practice one a little bit, please do so.
Yeah.
I say, don't hesitate to be abusive about it. I don't care, you see. I do my best. And the fact that it's inadequate is something my family always makes. You notice the friendly societies in that they didn't go away. And the registrar of friendly societies still exists, although the friendly societies are more like building societies than they exist. But certainly, and again, many of the old friendly societies have only that sent their records to the recorder. That's basically a requirement. It's the recorder that actually sent them to the archivist and they so often, if you know of a local friendly society, tracking it down is not that easy. But there are many sort of things. But I do recommend, if you do have something vocal to your part of the world, go into the museum, try your finger archivist, try and find out something about what they did, on what day, where, and things of that sort, because it draws as it were provides you with something to say to the Craig, which happens to make it. Right, in your sets of six, if I say the first eight bars are a Morris Hay, in the sense of the top turn eight, you do a figure eight, the bottom's turn eight, the figure eight, and the middles follow the tops. Do you understand what I mean? Let's walk in and see who does it.
Bottom,
get back to the bottom. The owls will come up in the middle of Five after the bar and start. Right. Now, having got cast them back to the base, we face each other and we do four steps. Now we have another one of these bits to show. What's a local step? But whatever you like, really, it's if you should please themselves. The only thing I ever came across, again, from the same, the Hampshire Dorset border, is that they did. They like to put the foot down to the thigh. And particularly the men used to try and snap the whole foot down to the back. Probably all right, we've got boots on the right. The alternative, if you appreciate, is this simple back step. Ascending, up to you. Right. Four bars of step. One, two, three, four, and then push and ring. Put your stave forward and just dance ring once. Let's go back to where you started. Let's try once through the seat. The furthest east. it came from Wiltshire. So where does it really come from? The answer I don't know. Not possible. But if I had any idea today, I could look up the church records and which wedding it was, and I would know where the groom came from. Sort of thing, you know. And in fact, we've actually done this within our family. So, first of all, I'll do is teach what I think is the basic movement, right? And then, because in fact it's simplistic as a dance, I'll teach at least one way that I know how a side is actually extended. I'll use that word rather than improve, because improvement depends on what we're using it for. No, and if you actually have a ready bride and groom in the middle or something like that, that's all. Now, wedding reels were collected by the Flits in Scotland, particularly in the Highlands and the Islands. That's a little cumbersome thing, you see. They also got a number of five-man reels as well, I might say. And when I talked to one, they weekend of the cream from Leonardo, whatever the sports in the future. They were saying, well, you know, I mean, they have famed similar sort of things in the late history and so on. And what's more, five-hand reels, the thing I didn't believe at the time, they were very often Sparkford, Dorset. So then we started saying, well, what about wedding reels? And they were like, oh, yes, you know, there are references to them and so on. So it's all part of what the culture that Thomas Hardy spoke about at the EFS in the early days. When he was a young lad, before the country dances were being done by the peasants in the world, they did the reels and the jukes and things of that sort. So, yes, there's good reason to be a dance. Right. Now, face across, four double steps, seven steps on the left. Go to their right between the ends, and then they dance what I would like to call half a reel of three, but really they just go around there and the other two cross over. So we just change the side. Then you do four passes of stepping again. The little go to their right again between the other two, you dance a half a reel.
Thank you.
notations, counted out notations. Some of it was difficult to track then, what it actually meant. Particularly something called the figure. So he thought, well, what on earth can that mean, the figure? Something was so unknown that you didn't have to explain it. So we talked to Pat Shaw, who was an expert, you know, on interpreting these things. And he started out by saying, well, it's like right and left through, you know. It all depends which decade you're talking about. There are many ways of interpreting these. The real thing is the figure means the figure eight. You know, and really it's no problem, it's just a figure eight. The question is, who's party to it? Well, there are problems, you see. Reels and paddies don't differ. You know, there's three people involved in each. They don't differ except the way you go into it. Right? There's only a subtle distance between them. So I said, well, what's the figure? He said, oh, well, it's when a pair dance the figure eight. They range somebody else like your father's, didn't they? He said, I've got six people. Ah, he said, you mean that figure of eight. Right. The way we're going to do it is going to work in pairs. In other words, with your partner, right, we're going to dance the figure eight. Which means we're going to go that way round, right? So you follow him, you follow her, you follow her, right? And off you start going that way, right? That way. You go that way, on, and you go across and follow her. Right? Wait, through.
Thank you. right. Can I borrow you for a moment? Which we're dancing with, we can simulate a pair of chairs. When you do the figure, right, this set, you start with the figure. Go on. Go that way. You see, they already make one mistake. Now, the objective is to actually stop the bride and groom getting together. So, when they're going round the first time, when they get, you don't pause in the column. Right? You have to keep moving and turn back as quickly as you can to make sure there's somebody between. And at the end, your stave going before you get a chance to get to each other, you put your stave in. Spot. It's much more fun with garlands. You can do it with garlands, you have to catch them. Let's assume that we can do that version of the dance. So, that's perfectly alright to my mind, to dance day, outside a church. You know, much more fun than just making an arch. Or at reception, or things like that. Anything more complicated takes too much trouble to learn. Particularly if you haven't done it since the last wedding in the family, as it were. But for a show dance, yeah, it tends to need something a bit more, ending of some sort. So now, I've seen quite a few times try things, put something on the end of it. It tends to work quite well. But Wendy Crouch and she does it slightly differently, I find that rather fun as well. So we're just saying, you face across, and then go from the beginning again. You do your four bars to step in, the middle's going to the right to change sides. Right, everybody change sides. And then, the same middles go to their left, and do a complete reel of three with the two they've just done. So you go all the way around, all reel of three. Ending up where you started the reel of three, so everybody's on the wrong side. You don't have to worry, we do this more than once. Then we do the figure eight. Just done the figure eight. Now bring up your right hand and go back to your right hand. Then, the top pair, face down, are going to do a dip and dive hay, making arches when you go over and putting your stave on your shoulder when you go under. Having your stave high in the air will cause confusion, right? So you go under, over, and you go under. Then the last movement is that you push around to opposite, halfway around, and then do a loop to your left on your own, and come back and push around halfway and loop around. So that's a three loop figure eight to walk on your own. Sure about that? You just push around halfway to change side. Do walk it again. Halfway, do a loop. Halfway, and do a loop. No karate chops there. That's Farmington's 6-8 bars. Following me, step crossover, back to each side, yeah. Stepping crossover, reels across the top, across the ends, I should say, the figure both ways, and then the dip and dive, and the turn and loop.
Thank you.
It's also got a side industry records, so you can look up and see what your team said they were doing up to years ago.
Right? And on the other side, that's right, the alternate one. So you go into one long line and dance back. Then change the side of who you cross with and into line again. Something else, right? and it was to something else which was much more interesting. Everybody face up. The top pair cast, and as soon as the second pair pass them, they go into a reel of four. Across, sorry. Go across. What you should find, I'll get this set maybe do it, there they ought to do it, right? Pop your castles into the real easy passing their shoulders. But what happens here at this point, he tends to have an extra loop of range to do, and we find it quite easy to forget that one. Make sure you've got back in time. So, there's nothing wrong about cutting the last corner if your number one is going forward again. It all depends how you get around the position. That's the figure of any of us. It gets much more difficult one in there, that's where you have a figure for six. Everybody do a half turn to the left. You've got your left on the other side, haven't you? And then rain go forward. Do you want to walk the figure again? Do we have an A and then a B for the figure? The middle four, it's going to be fairly obvious, but it's going. They go through their ends. And the end, the corner four, who is Tom Rain, start reels of four across the diagonal. So coming to the middle, view, and you right. And you start by passing left shoulders in the middle. Go on, carry on. And start passing the other on the back. On the back.
The next one is called Thirdly. Speed of Now. Another one of these wonderful dance choruses which hair of rise and miraculous. There was a dance once done on Plymouth Navy at some park. It didn't work very well, so I modified it to the Midland Road across the village. And they didn't like it, so they had to rewrite that dance called the New Cross of the Village. And the further they somehow acquired a bit of that, they were the ones called Stave Dancing as the place. So we end up with a sort of, right, within your eights. The top four face down, the bottom four face up. And you move on one double step into two lines of four face down. On the second double step, the top line who are now facing the wrong way turn inwards to face the other way. Inwards, that's right. Now, you've got two double steps. You're going to work as a pair, and you as a pair, and you're going to rotate at the end. Right? Rotate while you move into a line of
thank you. let's stand.
Thank you.
Face up.
If I'm honest, the original notation also has it with a putting your stave there and stepping on the spot. But I've never found it work satisfactorily. Well, it tends to get a bit stuck. So we miss that today. Right, from where you were or where you are or where, if you would like, we dance the Sussex Polka. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Originally, by the Stave, and there are actually some tunes called
top parade, cast, keeping the set nice and wide, and then we approach. Approach your opposite. And that really represents the figure. Or you might say it represents the chorus. Another one of the problems with these things. It's something like that as we do between each of the other things. Now, in the repeat, now we've changed ends, we do it the other way. So we go forward, back step, then forward, face down, back step.
Thank you.
sound progressive. That takes a bit of believing. But it ended with the figure. Or I should have done, would do popular series, haven't we? The figure is the same figure that we did in the certain compliment. You cast from the top, right? As soon as they're ready, we're going to reel a six across. Off we go. There. All the way round, that's for money, all the way back to the other end. And when you meet your opposite coming the other way for the second time,
thank you.
weasel, which you probably don't know. Oh, but you know how it goes, eh? That's right, eh? Falls from the top, as they say in country dance circles. Second lady, top three people. Where'd you go? Yeah, funny, yeah, funny, yeah, funny, yeah, funny, yeah.